Okay, now we can go to another part of this triangle. I told you the golden triangle is cost, time, and scope, and specification. So when you work with cost, you figure out what are the cost components and how can you manage that. Now time is here, our goal or our objective is to find out how long the project will take, which means we will make an estimate for the total project duration. That's what actually we are doing here when we're looking at time. And also we would like to look into the work packages that are critical, which means that if anything happens in these work packages, they will have impact on total project duration. So time planning, or if you want, scheduling is the thing we are going to talk about. How many relationships we have? Luckily, they are not really many. So we can cook down all these relationships into only four. Let's look at them. Now, I told you, our starting point is this way to break down stuff. And then we have, you know, these boxes. And let's say we have one word package is called A, and another word package is called B. Now we can ask, what kind of relationship between A and B can exist? One would say, one relationship, now think of time. One relationship can say, B can only start if A is finished. So finishing A is a precondition to start B. This is the very first sequential relationship. It's called like this. Finish to start. And this is the most common sequential relationship you will find between work packages. And again, it says B can start when A is finished. Or if I may reformulate to be more precise, the earliest time that B can start is when A is finished. Earliest time. That's why we call it here the earliest time. So this date here, we put here, is the earliest start. The earliest start date of B is when A is finished. Sometimes, because of contextual factors, we add a delay. A delay, which means that the earliest start of B can take place X days after A is finished. So here, actually, what should we write here? This is the early finish for A. Now you can see, we say early start for B can take place X days after early finish of A. Now we can even make it a little bit fancy. We can make it minus X, which means that we say early start of B is minus X days, or X days before early finish of A. This is the most common used sequential relationship, finish to start relationship. Okay, is that all? No, there are other relations. Let's say A and B. Again, how can we link these together? And let me now introduce this early start. Each activity has an early start and has an early finish, an early start and early finish. What other relationships can exist between these two. One of them, for instance, we can say these two can begin together. So the L start of B is equal to the L start of A, which means that these two should start at the same time. That's what it says. We can start them at the same time. And you have already figured it out. We call it SS relationship, because start to start relationship. And we can add this X. It's a lag or it's a delay. They can overlap each other a little bit if it's minus, and they have to be delayed a little bit if it is positive. And the third relationship we have, we call it again L start, L finish, L start, or L finish. This one, I assume you already guessed it. It's finish, finish. We call it finish to finish. Which says that B must, not must, or the early finish for B, early finish for B is equal to early finish of. If A is delayed, B will also be delayed. So the finish points will be connected to each other. And again, it might be a delay or a lag. And the final one, which is hardly used, or you will not really find it in many places, it is the start to finish. This one is a little bit weird. This says, when you start A, you have to finish B. So B could have been started, could have started any time here. Any time, could have started here. But at the moment you start another activity called A, this one should be stopped. A typical example, if you, for instance, have, let's see, you are working on a road project, and you have one activity which is called like a side road. You have established a side road so that the vehicles can drive on this road while you are building the main road. Right? So, when this main road, this is the commissioning of the main road. Handing over, you hand it over. Immediately, when you hand over this road to your client, this one should be stopped. You can't use it anymore because your main road now is open for business. So when you start this, you have to stop this. This is like side road, some temporary system you have while you are making that big system. But at the moment you commissioning this one, you no need to have this. Then you have to stop it. Then you have to delete it. This is a kind of start to finish relationship. These are the main categories of activities. Sequential relationship. And then what we do next? As you can see, we have to make a table or a diagram or a network with all these relationships. And then for each one of them, we should define what will be the duration. And now, let me use only duration in days or in weeks or in months. We will not go the difficult way, we will go the right way. Say activity A has a duration of 2, activity B has a duration of 3, activity C has a duration of 4, 5, 6, 7, and then the next stage is to construct a network that connects all your web packages together on a timeline. And to do this job, we use this activity on node technique. Example. And for simplicity, I will only use finish to start. Next lecture, I will look into networks where you have another or additional types of networks. So let's just very simple network. We have like this. And this way. And now we become 2. And become 1. And this is A. And let's say it has a duration of 3 weeks. B has a duration of 5. C has a duration of 6. A, B, C, D has a duration of 4. F, A, P, has a duration of 2. F has a duration of 3. And G has a duration of 10. And let's say we have only one type of relationship between all these activities. And they are finish to start. And let's say this is the finish to start 0, and this is the finish to start 0, and this is finish to start 3. And this is working like this, and this goes like this, like that. Again, finish to start 0, finish to start 0. And here, finish to start 1. And both of them finish to start 0, and here, finish to start 0. So we converted here the work breakdown structure into a network. And this kind of network is what we refer to activity on node network. And this is the one we really. So this is the one which is mostly used now in project management. There's another one called activity on arc. AOA. This is not very much used now. And this one is easy to use because we can put the data directly in a computer and it will calculate everything for us. So now we have established this network. Now, can I ask you, what will be the total project duration now? How long it will take to complete this project? What do you think? Can anyone here, just by looking at this network, tell me what will be the total project duration? Exactly. But I was just thinking, maybe somebody can see it directly from the numbers here. Anyone can see how it will look?
23 weeks.
Huh?
23.
20 weeks. Okay. Let's check this one.
Oh, 23.
Okay, let's check this one. In order to check what this gentleman has said, we need this algorithm that you have talked about. There is an algorithm called the critical path method. It's a mathematical process, helps us to find out what is the total project duration, and not the least, which one of these activities are critical, are very important when it comes to time. How do we establish this critical path method? We need a notation. This notation, I can just bring it out here. I want this. Yeah, hey. These are one way to identify the notation in each web page. For instance, here you have, you write the L start, and here you write the L finish, and here you write the late start, and here you write the late finish. And here you write your name of your activity. And in this notation, they put the duration here. Right? I just put it between parentheses. But you can put it down. So this is how we draw these numbers in each web page. And that, now let's begin to verify if it is 22 weeks or if it is more. Where we begin? We begin always with the very first, of course, activity, right? And we go always from right, now, from left to right. So this is our axis of movement, from left to right. And we begin always with this L start to L finish. Our goal is to find L start or L finish for each web package. And then we will go back and find late finish and late start for each. If there is a difference between them, then you have a slack or you have a float, which means that you really don't need to hurry up this activity if you have a bad time. But if the float or slack is zero, then you must hurry up. You must do it right. Otherwise, all your project will be delayed. Okay, help me now. Now, this is advanced mathematics. We start with writing zero. And zero here, there is no week called week zero. You know that? But zero, when we write zero, we mean the beginning of week number one. The first day of week number one. That's why we put zero. Like, look at the ruler. It starts with zero, it doesn't start with one. And that's why we start with zero. And then, what will be the early finish of A? Zero plus three is B. What will be the early start of B? Three plus zero, three. What will be the early start of C? 3, just follow the line, 3. And what will be the early start of D? 3 plus 3 is 6. Now we go. What is the early finish of B? 3 plus 5 is 8. 3 plus 6 is 9. 6 plus 4 is 10. Now, what will be the early start of F? Now you have 9 and 10. What should be the early start? Yes, when you go this path, you always select the highest number, which is 10. And 10 plus 3 is 13. Now we look from this side. 8 plus 1 is 9. And here is 9. So these two actually are identical. Then we say the early start is 9. 9 plus 2 is 11. And here we stand between 11 or 13. Which one we should use? We should use always the highest number, which is 13. 13 plus 10 is 23. So yes, it is 23. Correct. But now, which one of these activities are critical? Which means that they have zero float. We can check that the other way. We will go back and calculate the late finish and the late start. go back and the late finish for G is equal to the early finish, which means that 23 minus 10 is 13, 13 minus 0 is 13, 13 minus 3 is 10. Now you just go back. Go. 10 here, 10 minus 4 is 6, and we can wait a little bit. And then we want to find here for C. It becomes 10 minus 0 is 10, 10 minus 6 is 4, right? And what about here? It is 13, we go back. 13 minus 2 is how much? 11. You see, from this line, it's 11. Two options. From F we had 10. And from E, the option is 11. Which one we use when we go back? 10, the smallest one. Always, you use the smallest one. And here it would be 10. It's only one link. 11 minus 8 is?
10 minus.
How much is it?
10 minus 5.
11 minus 5, of course. How much is it?
10 6. Minus.
And now, look at this. 11 minus 5, how much? 6.
But it was finished to start 1, so mid minus.
Is it 10?
Yeah.
Why?
11 minus 1.
But this one is 11, and then you go back?
11 minus 1.
Finish to start, it was 1.
Ah, very good, thank you. I entirely forget about that one. Thank you. 11 minus 1, not bad. You really are good. 10 minus 5 is 5. Yes, thank you. And now, we go back. What will be the early? Late finish of A. Now you have this 5, right? And you have 4, and you have the 6. Which one we use? Are you sure? And we need to go back and take into account this 3. 6 minus 3 is 3, or 4, or 5. Of course, it should be 3. 0. So now your critical work packages are A, and why it's critical. Because you see, there is no slack whatsoever. It will start on day one and will finish at the end of week three. This and late start is zero, and late finish is zero. This is no slack whatsoever. What about B? What is the slack of B? 2, 10 minus 8. So here you have 2 days or 2 weeks slack. If you need, you can extend the duration with 2 weeks without losing anything. And here, what is your slack? Is 1. And here, what is your slack? Is 0. Then this is a critical. Of course, this is also a critical. This is not a critical, this is 2. You have a slack of 2. And this is critical. So, in this project, your critical path is A, D, F, G. And your total project duration is 23 weeks. And this technique is what we refer to the critical path method. This is like a fundamental thing in scheduling. Figuring out how to define or what kind of relationships you need in order to calculate it right. And then the rest, as you can see, is quite easy. This is very important now because a lot of things that we will do after will be based on that, especially when we do control. And we can analyze the situation. What will happen if we extend the duration of C with 2 weeks? What is the impact? And then we will take this after the breaks. So just to recap, these are the major tasks in time planning. you identify sequential relationships between the different activities, and you conduct duration estimation, and we said that you can estimate directly or through estimation of the workload itself in man hours. I'll come back to how we convert from man hours into a duration in the next lecture. So in this lecture, we just keep ourselves to a duration that has been given. And then we do this scheduling. We establish this network diagram, and we identify total project duration and the critical path and the float for each web package. This is actually scheduling in a nutshell. Now, how do we define the dependencies between web packages? When, while we say sometimes A can start to, or when we start A, we should finish B, or when we start, when we finish A, we should also finish B. There are no exact rules for that, except some generic considerations. We have sometimes we call mandatory requirements. Mandatory requirements are in the sense that you actually cannot paint a wall, right? Let's say if you are working on in a waterfall model, you cannot paint a wall before you actually build it, right? This is a mandatory requirement. Two activities can only be executed after each other. This is the only way. And sometimes we know from best practice that two activities can be done together, or that one of them should be done and then wait for the other one to reveal risks, for instance. For instance, in software applications, usually we do this amendments of documentations together with system testing. We test the system and we upgrade the documentations attached to this system. And sometimes we do that because of external factors. Let's say this in this activity, A is something one contractor has to do it, and B is something another contractor has to do. And this contractor is available in particular time period. Then we say, okay, we start B after A is finished, and we give even some waiting time to make sure that the second contractor or the B contractor will be available. These are the rules that decide what kind of relationships you should have in your plan. And we said you have finished to start with delay or without delay, and you have start to start when two things can start together, and we say we have finished to start, finished to finish with or without delays, and finally start to finish activity. And again, when we do the estimation methods, how do we estimate the durations? We use the past experience, again, analog for expert opinion, analog for mathematical models are used, and we also include the uncertainty of the estimation, usually with the help of this PLO estimation. So the same technique we use in order to include the uncertainty in the estimates, we also use it to include or to compensate for uncertainty in the duration estimation. The result of the first phase of our scheduling method, as you can see, is a table lined up. We have activities or work packages, and we define the durations, and we define the predecessors. And we use this one. Right? This is the one we use when we want to build the schedule. In many situations, we go directly for this network diagram. We jump over this table. But it is recommended that you build the table first before you go over to the diagram. this is just a very quick some terms that you perhaps it could be an advantage for you to learn. Successors, these are tasks that cannot be started until previous tasks are complete. In this case, D is a successor for B and C, right? You can't start this one before these two have started. Predecessors, C and D are predecessors for D. These are just the names we use. A network diagram, this is called a network diagram. It's a display of the relationship between activity. This is also called a network diagram. And you have, of course, series activities. In series activities, you have only finished to start. And you have parallel activities. In parallel activities, usually you have start-to-start relationship. The good thing about network diagram like this one, as you can see, the most important thing, it shows the dependency between all web packages. That's a good thing about it. You can look at the diagram and see without any doubt who should start first and what. And of course, again, you remember, a good plan is a plan that facilitates communication. And if with this diagram we help defining the project duration. And when we define the project duration, we also define the schedule or the critical path. And when you define a critical path, you ask yourself, which of these activities are very important? Which means that which of these activities we are going to push in resources so that we finish it on that time. So it helps you in resource planning. You know where are your priority. Your priority here is A, B, F, G. This can wait a little bit. This can wait a little bit. This can wait a little bit. There is something called activity on arc versus activity on node. I hate activity on arc. It's confusing sometimes. And nobody really uses it. And if you open any software package, like Microsoft Project, or like Safran, or like Primavera, all of them, they use activity on node. So this is my thing, activity on node. In activity on arc, you have the nodes, they represent time, start and finish. And the lines represent activity. And there are a lot of limitations concerned or connected to activity on arc structure. But activity on node, your web package is the node itself. And the lines are the relationship between them. And this is how we define the notation. The most important is these two corners. You have early start, early finish. And these two corners, you have late start and late finish. Activity duration can come here. The float can be there. It doesn't really matter. But the corners that are important. Serial activities, as the name says, these are things that has to be done in a sequence. Just finish to start relationships. And activities in parallel, like the name says, you have concurrent or parallel execution of activities. And we have something called merge activity, which means activity D merges. Connects or mix the output of the three previous activities. For instance, here, this is a merge activity. This is a merge activity. This is a merge activity. And we have something called burst activity. A, for instance, is a burst activity. From it comes many other links. And at the end of the day, we have a network. And what we want actually is to find again the critical mass. And to study, this will help us to study the consequences of changing something, deleting something, expanding something. What will be the impact on project duration? This is, I would like to take it as an example. How can we analyze a network? And for simplicity, I will only use finish to start. In the next lecture, I will expand it to other. Maybe we can keep these four so that you remember, and we try a new network. And now we will construct the critical path and then examine what could happen. And maybe we can use this network, right? And we have A. This is you assign a contract. And then you have B. And this is the design phase. This is market something. And then you do a survey somewhere here. D. This one is a finish to start, finish to start, I guess. And here you have the, you studied the demographics. And where else? Here you have a survey. The from B goes to the D. And then you here develop your presentation, E. And here you do analysis, F. And right, and at the end, you have your presentation. Or, let me write just an image. And in order to do this presentation, you should finish with your draft, you should finish with your analysis, and you should finish with your demographics, right? So this is our network diagram, and we got the following information about the network. The contract, this is like 5, and the market ID is like 6, duration, and the B is 5, and the D is 13, and the G is 9, and the E is 6, and the F is 4, and the H is 2. Okay, now you can help. We will figure out what will be the total duration and what are the critical parts. Step by step, we start with Z. 5. This is a burst activity. Then this is a successor. 5, 5. 5 plus 5 is 10. 5 plus 6 is 11. And you have 10 and 11, right? And you have a merge. What do you use when you have a merge between two predecessors? You use the largest number. 11 plus 13, 24. 10, 16, 11, 20, 24. 24 plus 4 is 28. Now this is a merge between 16, 28, and 20. What we use? 28. 28 plus 2 is 30. Correct? Also, we go back. 30. 28. And we just follow the arrow. 28. 28 minus 9 is 19. And then we go back. 28. 24. 28 minus 6, 22. And then this one. 24 minus 13 is how much?
11.
How much is it? 11, yes. And then now this is the burst of these two. Which duration we should put here? 19 or is it 11?
11.
11 again. 11 minus 6 is 5. Go back. You have 11 or 22. What we put? 11. 11 minus 5 is 6. And you have 5 here, and you have 6 here. So what you end up with is 5. And now you can see that this is your critical path. And your total project duration is 30, and the critical path is A. This market, what we call it, C, right? C and D and F and H. Now, if I ask you now, what will be the consequences of, let's say, increasing the duration of B from 5 to 6. What happens if we increase the duration of B from 5 to 6? That is, we discovered that we need actually 6 weeks to develop this. What do you think? What will happen? Anything will happen? Any suggestion? In order to answer that question, what you need to look at is the float. You have a float of 1. So because you have a float of 1, which means that you are free, you have a planning freedom to extend the duration with 1 week. So if you put it 6 here, the only thing that will happen that you will have 11 and 11. And the B become critical. Then by expanding the duration of B with 1 week, you get not only 1 critical path. What you get actually is 2 critical paths. One of them is A, B, D, F, H, and the other one is A, C, D, A, C, D, F, H. So expanding a duration of 1 activity might not impact the duration, but it might impact the critical path. Suddenly, you will have several critical paths in your network. And the same can be applied to 2E. Now, I said we increase B with 1, right? What will be the impact on E? What if we increase it by 1? As you can see, the float here was 14, right? No, 12. If you increase this one by 1, the float will be less here. By 11. It will become short. So, increasing 1 activity can impact the critical path and also impact the total float in your network. That's why each time you change the numbers, you should look back into the float. What happened to that float? Because this float will be very important next lecture when we start allocating resources. It will help us a lot to move resources where we actually need them, and to move them away from places where we don't really need them. It's a good way to remember how to move your... and this is the entire network. How do we make the project shorter? that young man told me for a while that the critical path is the longest path in the network. Yes, it is the longest path. How can we make it short? Yeah, if you want to make your project short, then you have to look at your critical path and try to shorten these activities at first. So rather than shortening E and B, you should be shortening A, D, A, C, D, F, and H. We can try to overlap, maybe. Maybe we can change these activities or these relationships between finish to start to, for instance, overlap them a little bit. Finish to start minus one, that we can start, for instance, D one day before B is finished, or one day before C is finished. This is the way to speed up your critical path. And what, how, when we want to shorten, what is our recommended order? Early task. When you want to shorten, don't go and shorten these ones. Go and shorten these ones. Because they are in the near future. You have better control over them. And number two, when you want to shorten, as you can see, for instance here, H is two. It's too small to shorten. But D is 13, it's too long. Maybe this one should be shortened rather than shortening the shortest one. And at the end, the easiest tasks. If it is between, for instance, B and C, and you know, this one is too easy for you, then you try to shorten that to reduce the uncertainty. And the last option is you shorten the ones that cost you the least to shorten. And in the next lecture, you will learn a technique called crashing. Like when you short any of these activities, your costs will go up. So you will have to select these ones that gives you less cost increase when you want to reduce the total DH. And this and others will be the subject of the next lecture. Next lecture, you will learn more about how you do the crashing. You will learn more about how you allocate resources using the critical path to move resources, put resources, calculate resources. And we will look into how you overlap, how you use, or what will be the impact of using other relationships than finish to start. That's all for today.